In this particular module, we are revisiting the concept of ANCOVA. We had introduced in a previous module the concept of ANCOVA, or a mixture form of the linear model where we have covariates as well as factors into our model, and we look at fitting this model. So in this particular module, we are going back to the model fitted using the ANCOVA technique, and we are looking at the inferential perspective. So once the model are fitted, to test the significance of the covariates, and also by looking at the covariates and the factors interaction effect, how we perform the test of hypotheses is what we have focused on in this chapter, in this module. In one of the modules, we had started discussing and introducing a new kind of linear model, which is the ANCOVA model. The ANCOVA model is basically a general linear model which blends ANOVA and regression. In case of regression, we have seen that there is one dependent variable and one or more independent variable which are associated with each other. In case of regression, we consider both the dependent and the independent variable to be continuous, and the existence of association between the two is explored, and we develop a mathematical model in the form of a regression model which is used as a predictive tool. In case of ANOVA, however, it can be thought of as a special case of regression where we do not have continuous x variables, but instead we have factors, or we have the x variables which are different factors taking values 1, 2, 3, 4 and so on. And because we use a categorical variable in case of the independent variable x, we have eventually what is called the analysis of variance. So the variability in the response which is attributed to any one of the factors, that is what is explored, or that is what we look at and test in case of an analysis of variance model. Now ANCOVA is a blend between the two, in the sense that you have a list of x variables which can be some of them continuous and some of them they can be categorical. So we take them together and we fit them into a model which is called the ANCOVA model. So it can be written in the form of a general linear regression model, or a general linear model to be precise, which is of the form y equals x beta plus epsilon. Depending on what form the columns of x takes, we accordingly have a regression model, an ANOVA model, or a ANCOVA model. So the ANCOVA procedure, let us look at how it's described. We assume that a linear relationship exists between the response variable, or the dependent variable, and the covariate. And it's written in the following form: yij equals mu plus tau I plus b times xij minus xi bar plus epsilon ij, where yij is the jth observation under the ith categorical variable or the categorical group. Mu is the grand mean. Tau I is the effect of the ith level of the independent variable. Xij is the jth observation of the covariate, which is continuous, under the ith group. And xi bar is the ith group mean. And epsilon ij is the associated unobserved error term. Now we had discussed how an analysis of covariance model is developed, how we write it, and how we interpret each of the parts of this model. In this particular module, we are going to talk about the null hypothesis. As in the case of any other linear model, once we fit it, we usually try to fit by estimating the coefficients of the linear model by using the method of least square or maximum likelihood. And once we have estimated, our logical next step is to look at the significance, or to test the significance of the factors and the covariates in the model itself. So that is exactly what we will discuss here. Let us now look at the null hypothesis. How do we make a statement about the null hypothesis of an ANCOVA? The null and the alternative hypotheses for ANCOVA are similar for those of ANOVA. Conceptually, however, these population mean have been adjusted for the covariate. In case of ANOVA, if you recall, the null hypothesis that we test is mu 1 equals mu 2 equals mu r, where we have r population or r different factors which classifies the population, and we test whether the mean value of the response is the same across them or there is a significant difference between at least one of them as compared to the rest. So we do the same thing here in case of ANCOVA. However, because this model contains not just the factors but also the covariates, we assume that the same null hypothesis is tested. However, we have adjusted for the effect of covariate on the responses. Versus, the alternative hypothesis is of the same form as ANOVA, where we test that mu I not equals mu k for some ik. So we are testing whether at least one pair ik is significantly different from the rest. If we test statistic is the next step that we have to define in case of testing of a hypothesis. The null hypothesis once decided upon, we now look at the test statistic and how to find the value of the test statistic, then to perform the testing of the hypothesis. So the test statistic for ANCOVA is the F ratio of the adjusted between group mean square MS between to the adjusted within groups mean square MS within. The underlying distribution of this test statistic is the F distribution with k minus 1 and n minus k minus 1 degrees of freedom, where k is the number of covariates, n is the total number of observations, k minus 1 is the degrees of freedom of MS between, and n minus k minus 1 is the degrees of the freedom of MS within. We write the test statistic or calculate the test statistic as follows. F equals MS between divided by MS within, which follows an F distribution with k minus 1 times n minus k minus 1 degrees of freedom under the null hypothesis. Now, while conducting an ANCOVA, because we have seen that a number of assumptions are working on a linear model when we try to fit one, and these assumptions we try to make sure before fitting any linear model, we try to make sure that these assumptions are met with. In case of conducting an ANCOVA, also we have to keep in mind that the same assumptions as that of any linear model also holds good in case of an analysis of covariance model. So let us look at the following, which are the steps to conduct ANCOVA. Here, CV would mean covariates, DV would mean dependent variable or the response variable, and IV would mean the categorical independent variable in this case. Now, testing the multicollinearity. First of all, when we look at a regression model or a linear model with a number of independent variables, we first try to test for multicollinearity. What we understand by multicollinearity is that if you have several x variables, there is an underlying association between them. Now, if it so happens that two or more than two of these x variables are highly correlated to one another, then fitting the regression model with that particular data set is going to lead us to the problem of multicollinearity. And briefly, the problems of fitting a model where there is multicollinearity amongst the independent variables is that we look at the significance of the model as a whole, which can turn out to be significant. However, if there is multicollinearity, two or more of the x variables individually would turn out to be insignificant. And also, it overestimates the values of the coefficients, so it makes the testing of the significance of these coefficients null and void. So we need to test for multicollinearity in case of an analysis of covariance model as well. If a CV is highly related to another CV at a correlation of 0.5 or more, then it will not adjust the DV over and above the other CV. One or the other should be removed since they are statistically redundant. So for an example, if we are looking at estimating or regressing expenditure of an individual on their income as well as on their wealth, the two variables income and wealth will tend to be very highly correlated to one another, which is going to lead to the problem of multicollinearity. So one way of getting rid of this problem is by removing one of the pair which is highly correlated and fitting the model using the other one. The second is the test of homogeneity of variance assumption. This is the assumption of homogeneity. We assume that in a linear model, the error term epsilon happens to follow a normal distribution with mean mu and variance sigma square. Now, it's expected that the variance across the different values of epsilon are same, that is, it's sigma square. But in cases we see, we fit a regression model and the residuals or the errors that we get, those when plotted against either the fitted values or the observed values of the independent variable, they show a particular pattern. If this is the case, then we know that there is heterogeneity in the model, which means that the different variables, the different area error terms, they have different variance, and this is not accepted. So after the violation of this assumption, we try to look at transformation of the independent variable and fit the model one more time, or also look at the transformation of independent variables as well and fit the model once more, so that eventually we get the residuals from the fitted model which do not show a pattern when plotted against either the independent variable or the fitted values of the dependent variable. There are certain tests which helps us identify whether this problem of homogeneity and heterogeneity exists or not. So, testing for homogeneity, it is tested by Levine's test of equality of error variances. This is most important after adjustments have been made. If we have it before adjustment, we are likely to have it afterwards as well. So, in case you have transformed the data and the problem doesn't exist, then the transformation indeed has helped in finding a homogeneous set of error terms. Otherwise, the homogeneity cannot be tested for. Also, testing for the homogeneity of regression slope assumption. To see if the CV significantly interacts with the IV, we run an ANCOVA model including both the IV and the interaction term between the CV and the IV. If the interaction term is significant, ANCOVA should not be performed. So just like we were talking about multicollinearity, where there is a significant association between the CV and another CV, in this particular assumption, we are looking at CV significantly, whether it interacts with the IV or not. So in case it significantly interacts and the interaction term happens to be significant, then ANCOVA should not be performed. Instead, Green and Salkin suggest assessing group differences on the DV at particular levels of the CV. Also, we consider using a moderated regression analysis, where we treat the CV and its interaction as another IV. Alternatively, however, one could also use mediation analysis to determine if the CV accounts for the IV is effect on the DV. And finally, when we run an ANCOVA analysis, while conducting an ANCOVA, when we run the ANCOVA analysis, if the CV and IV interaction is not significant, we rerun the ANCOVA without the interaction of CV and IV. In this analysis, we need to use the adjusted mean and the adjusted mean square error. The adjusted mean, also referred to as the least square mean or the LS mean, estimated marginal mean or EMM, refer to the group mean after controlling for the influence of the CV on the DV. So after we run the ANCOVA, when we look up at the follow-up analysis, if there was a significant mean effect, it means that there is a significant difference between the levels of one IV, ignoring all the other factors. So we were looking at conducting the ANCOVA, where first we test the interaction between the CV and the IV. Once we do that, we now, if we find that the interaction effect is significant, we know that the interaction effect should not be, the ANCOVA model should not be continued with. But in case it is insignificant, then we look at the effect of the main effects or the factors. So if there was a significant main effect, it means that there is a significant difference between the levels of one IV, ignoring all other factors. To find exactly which levels are significantly different from one another, one can use the same follow-up tests as for an ANOVA. If there are two or more IVs, there may be a significant interaction, which means that the effect of one IV on the DV changes depending on the level of another factor. One can investigate the simple main effects using the same method as a factorial ANOVA. So in case, in addition to one factor, we have two different factors, which means we have two IVs in the model, then we can test them similar to the way we tested ANOVA in case of a two-way or a three-way model. Now, interpretation of ANCOVA, when we fit an ANCOVA model and after we have performed all the testing of hypotheses, we need to know how to interpret the ANCOVA, because the final model that we get, the final significant robust model that we get, that will be used further as an interpretation of a predictive tool. So we need to understand what in each of the components of covariance analysis mean. So interpreting an analysis of covariance can present certain problem. So depending on the nature of the data and, more important, the design of experiment, we can interpret the analysis of covariance results. The ideal application for an analysis of covariance is an experiment in which subjects are randomly assigned to treatments or cells of a factorial design. Although in reality, most of the time, it is not possible to have a completely randomly assigned subject. However, we try our level best to keep the randomness intact. In that situation, the expected value of the covariate mean for each group or cell is the same, and any difference can be attributed only to chance, assuming that the covariant was measured before the treatments were applied. So in a randomized experiment, in case we can achieve the randomness of all the subjects being allotted to the different treatments, in a random experiment in which the covariate is measured after the treatment has been applied and has affected the covariate, interpreting the results of an analysis of covariance is difficult at best. In this situation, however, the expected values of the group covariate means are not equal, even though the subjects are assigned randomly. It is difficult to interpret the results of the analysis because you are asking what the groups would have been like had they not differed on the covariate, where in fact the covariate differences may be an integral part of the treatment itself because the treatment was applied afterwards. This problem is particularly severe if the covariate was measured in error. Now, the problem of interpreting results of design in which subjects are not randomly assigned to the treatment group is not easily overcome. This is one of the reasons why random experiment is even more important than random selection of subjects. So even if the selection of the subjects into the study or into the experiment was not random, when the experiment begins and they are assigned to the different treatments, the randomness at this stage is very, very important. It is difficult to overestimate the virtues of randomization, both for interpreting data and for making causal statements about the relationship between variables. Anyone using covariance analysis must think carefully about their data and the practical validity of the conclusions they draw. So in this module, we have learned the nuances of fitting an ANCOVA model and then focusing on the inferential aspects. When we fit any linear model, we find the estimates of the coefficient, and the next step is logically to test for the significance of the covariates or the factors or the continuous independent variables which are involved in the model. So we have looked at the different null hypotheses, the definition of these null hypotheses, and also the development of the test statistic to test those null hypotheses, as well as looking at the distribution of those test statistics, which can be used to test the significance of the factors involved in a model.